Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's webinar hosted by Miranda and Associados and Invest Africa. My name is Alexander Woods, and I'm the Partnerships Manager here at Invest Africa. And I wanted to take a few moments at the start to welcome you on behalf of Invest Africa. For those of you who don't know us, we're a platform for business leaders, investors, entrepreneurs to gain insight into doing sustainable business in Africa. Our network is made up of global organizations, private investors, fund managers, family offices, policymakers, and entrepreneurs. Together, they share a desire to identify synergies that add value and strengthen their position and business strategy for the continent. With over 60 years of heritage in promoting businesses and investment opportunities across the continent, we have developed our strategic position as the key voice of industry and government. Our DNA is connecting businesses and investors, and we do this here in London, throughout our chapter cities, and of course, and more importantly, on the continent itself. As many of you know, we lead investor missions to the continent throughout the year, having just returned from a successful mission to Angola, where Invest Africa was able to organize a packed program for our delegation, including meetings with the president and a number of his cabinet ministers. We have just confirmed our Ethiopia investor mission for the 3rd to the 5th of December this year, and please do get in touch if you would like to know more. Just before I hand over to the Miranda Law team, just a few points on the webinar itself. We will try and get a Q&A session at the end of the session. You should be able to submit your questions via the questions app, which is just located below. And again, so just put them there, and then once we get to the end of the presentation, I will go through them and we will have the opportunity to ask questions then. And so I think thank you very much again to Miranda Associados for co-hosting this event, and to Anna and Catarina for your invaluable insight on this topic. Over to you.
Thank you. Hello, this is Catarina, and I'm here with Anna. We are both partners of Miranda. Miranda is a 32-year-old firm based in Portugal that has established a network several years ago, which today covers all Lusophone countries in Africa, Equatorial Guinea, and many Francophone African countries and Timor-Leste. In Francophone Africa, we have law firms that exclusively work with us and some that we have helped established in Congo, Equatorial Guinea, Gabon, and Cameroon. We have for years followed the problems and issues related to foreign exchange concerning these countries, and have been following the developments that led towards the adoption of these new foreign exchange regulations for some years now. In this presentation, we are going to speak a bit about CEMAC and give you a bit of background about the organization itself, its foreign exchange regulations, the context that led to the adoption of the new CEMAC regulation, and its scope of application and entry into force. We are also going to cover the issue of the authority of the CEMAC regulation, and speak briefly about the main requirements and restrictions affecting companies, the sanctions, its enforcement, and how it differs from the enforcement process of the previous foreign exchange regulations, also the sanctions, and we're going to mention some of its facts and some of the difficulties that have been experienced.
So starting with the CEMAC background and the creation of the franc zone. The creation of the franc zone, more on an historical note, was the result of, was actually a reaction conducted by France mainly to the devaluation of the national currency after the World War II. And in 1945, the CHAF, the common currency of CEMAC, was created and started to be used amongst the then French colonies. Over time, some of those countries stopped using the CHAF. Other countries adopted actually the CHAF as their currency. That was the case of Equatorial Guinea, for instance, in 1985. The CHAF exchange rate is guaranteed through this direct link with the euro under monetary agreements between France and the CHAF countries. CEMAC, briefly mentioning a bit of the history of CEMAC, the Economic and Monetary Community of Central Africa, is an international regional organization that aims to promote economic and monetary integration among its members. It is six members, and the CEMAC has these two unions, the UDEAC and the UMAC. The UDEAC stands for the Customs and Economic Union, the UMAC for the Monetary Union. The principal or the main features of UMAC in what respect to what we are going to discuss today is the adoption of the common currency, the CHAF. The common currency is issued by the central bank, the BEAC. Through this treaty of 1994, the CEMAC states undertook then to adopt, comply, and enforce harmonized legislation. This harmonized legislation is applied directly on each of these CEMAC states, and Catarina will describe how this happened. But the first regulation that was issued aimed at creating this harmonized CEMAC state foreign exchange rules was this regulation 2 from 2000, from 29 April 2000. This regulation was probably not known by many of the players in this various industries in CEMAC countries during a number of years, and that is because the provisions of this regulation are not very detailed, they are not clear on many issues. Just to give you an example, the rule was clear under this 2000 regulation that companies and individuals should repatriate the funds back to the CEMAC countries. However, there was no express prohibition for holding and operating bank accounts offshore, meaning outside of these CEMAC countries. So it was unclear, to say the least, whether or not these individuals, the players in general, the agents, could have bank accounts outside of CEMAC countries, and if there were restrictions or not, other than the repatriation of funds. As a result of these and other circumstances, CEMAC states did not fully and consistently enforce the 2000 regulation. However, to our knowledge, no state was ever sanctioned because of this. And in reality, what happened in some of these countries was that specific legal regimes and contracts providing for special rules in terms of foreign exchange were signed or were granted by these states to private parties. That happened notably in the mining and in the petroleum sector. In recent years, CEMAC countries have been hit hard by a series of severe shocks. We know what has been happening in the oil industry and what has happened since 2014-15. Civil conflicts, a number of circumstances have led players, the CEMAC states, the IMF, to start discussions and to try to find solutions to restore the conditions for the stability and the growth of this region. And apparently, that is really what is behind the new regulation, which is to strengthen the enforcement of foreign exchange rules, mostly to rebuild the BEAC net foreign assets. the new CEMAC regulation, Catarina?
Was approved in this context on 20 December 2018 upon a proposal and a draft submitted by the BEAC governor. To our knowledge, or at least we haven't seen a version of this new CEMAC regulation published in the CEMAC's official gazette. According to the CEMAC treaty, a regulation enters into force 20 days after its publication, but it has been uploaded on the CEMAC and BEAC web pages, and the official position of the CEMAC institutions and the BEAC in particular is that its date of entry into force was 1 March 2019. Article 193 of this new regulation provides for what appears to be a grace period for economic agents to become compliant with the new regulations of 6 months. Counted from 1 March 2019, that period ended on 1 September 2019. However, through an instruction with number 5 dated of 10 June 2019 on the opening of offshore and onshore foreign currency bank accounts, the BEAC extended the grace period with respect to the regularization of accounts for 6 months. And a circular letter subsequently issued clarified that this extension ends on 10 December 2019. The CEMAC regulation doesn't exclude from its scope of application any sector and therefore is applicable to all economic agents, both credit institutions and institutions operating in the banking market and those that resort to it to perform their business. The CEMAC foreign exchange regulation has the nature of a regulation, and regulations are one of the various types of acts that the CEMAC institutions approve. The regulations can be approved either by the UDEAC Council of Ministers within the scope of the Economic and Customs Union or with respect to the Monetary Union by the UMAC Ministerial Committee. The BEAC Ministerial Committee is composed by two ministers of finance of each CEMAC state and an additional minister, but only the Minister of Finance, the minister in charge of currency and credit, has voting powers. For the approval of a CEMAC regulation within the UMAC, a unanimous vote is required. That means that this new CEMAC regulation was unanimously approved by all ministers of finance of each CEMAC state. It is in Articles 41, 43, and 47 of the CEMAC Treaty that the issue of the authority of CEMAC regulations is dealt with. And looking at those provisions, the conclusions that we can draw are that once they enter into force within the CEMAC, regulations are directly applicable and immediately enforceable in every CEMAC state. It is not necessary for a CEMAC state to approve legislation reproducing or implementing the provisions of a CEMAC regulation for it to become enforceable in that country. And even publication in a state official gazette isn't necessary. In addition, once that the regulation becomes into force, it applies notwithstanding any prior or subsequent conflicting national legislation. The regulation gets incorporated into the national legislation and ranks higher than laws, decree laws, ordinances, whatever, meaning that it will prevail over conflicting provisions of domestic laws. I'll exclude the constitutions because then we are talking about constitutional law issues, and that is another matter. In addition, the treaty makes clear that CEMAC regulations are mandatory in all their elements and are meant to be applied in a uniform manner. The consequence of this is that a state can't choose which provisions it will enforce and which it won't enforce, and can't do it through legislation or even through a contract, notably by giving through a contract rights that are in conflict with the regulation. This is something that has been emphasized because of the precedents that Anna mentioned in this new regulation. And in Article 184 of the new regulation, you will find the provision expressly stating that neither the states nor the central bank can derogate from the CEMAC regulation provisions, the foreign exchange regulation provisions, either through their own laws and regulations or through a contract. When we speak about the main requirements and restrictions of the new foreign exchange regulation, we need to bear in mind that they apply mostly to those who are considered foreign exchange residents. The concepts of residence can be found in Article 144 of the new CEMAC regulation, and there is also a definition of non-residence in Article 137. In addition, the BEAC has issued at least one circular letter adding some clarity to this concept. The idea of the regulation seems to be to consider that natural or legal persons with their usual residence or main center of economic interest in a CEMAC state, and in the case of individuals staying in a CEMAC state for more than 1 year or intending to carry out an activity for at least 1 year in a CEMAC area, are deemed resident. There is no definition in the regulation of main center of economic interest. Looking at the concepts that we can find in other sources dealing with foreign exchange issues, we can at least consider that a main center of economic interest will be the place where I develop the core of my activities and derive most of my income. It is particularly relevant to mention that in the concept of non-resident, the only case that is expressly excluded is with respect to companies is the case of companies that only perform temporary tasks under specific contracts in a CEMAC country and that are not registered in the RCCM, which is basically the trade, the company's registry of most of the CEMAC countries. In Equatorial Guinea, it has a different name. It's the Registro Mercantil, but it is like the Registre du Commerce of the other countries. Now, that means, and it is also confirmed by Article 144, that branches of foreign companies that have to be registered in this company's registry are considered as being foreign exchange residents, and this is expressly mentioned in Article 144. Uh, With respect to the main restrictions and requirements of the new foreign exchange regulations, we are only mentioning a few that look to us to be those more important, at least for our clients, since the enactment of these regulations. With respect, starting with bank accounts, basically the regulation with respect to offshore bank accounts allows foreign resident individuals to have them, but they need to be notified to the BEAC, but prohibits them for legal persons unless a prior authorization from the BEAC is obtained. With respect to onshore foreign currency bank accounts, individuals can have them. Companies will be able to have them if they get the prior authorization from the BEAC. The rules and procedures to obtain these authorizations are laid down in instruction number 5 of the BEAC, adopted on 10 June 2019. And basically, what it says is that with respect to offshore bank accounts, the applicants are the companies wanting to have these bank accounts. With respect to onshore bank accounts, the applicants need to be, although the companies can also be involved as applicants, need to be the CEMAC banks where the accounts will be opened. A bunch of documents need to be submitted to the BEAC, mainly regarding the applicant, the bank where the account is open, and the currency, and also the operations that the company wishes to carry out through the account. Most importantly, all of the instruction requires companies to explain why they want the bank accounts and why are they necessary. These foreign currency bank accounts, it follows from at least 3 provisions of the CEMAC regulations that they are supposed to be used for payments in foreign currency, and they are to be credited only with foreign currency. With respect to transactions between foreign residences, the idea is that shaft bank accounts be used. There is express prohibition in the foreign exchange regulation of in Article 30 that transactions between 2 resident entities be settled through offshore bank accounts, and there are prohibitions in articles 44 and 45 of the regulations of transactions being made on foreign currency bank accounts to cover local needs, or that shafts be foreign currency bank accounts be credited with shafts. So the idea is that between foreign residents, payments should be done through local bank accounts and in local currency. In addition to this the requirements more related to bank accounts and foreign and transactions between foreign residents, the regulation also provides for rules with respect to transactions between residents and non-residents, and that's what I'm mentioning when I talk about domiciliation. The idea is that all service and access exports and imports be declared, but at the same time that any exports and imports of an amount equal or exceeding 5 million CFA francs be domiciliated. Domiciliated is defined in the regulation as being to engage bank to, do the payments related to the transaction. But in reality, if you look at instructions regarding the domiciliation, which are instructions 6 and 7, those existing, because there is already an indication that there may be further instructions from the BEAC to give certain flexibility to certain requirements. The idea is that the domiciliation starts with a registration with the bank to say, I'm going to export, I'm going to import this asset, this service, and providing documentations to the bank regarding that transaction, so that then payments are processed through that bank. With respect to exports, the domiciliation procedure ends with the bank, or is supposed to end with a control and confirmation by the bank that the proceeds of the export done by a foreign resident have been repatriated, because the foreign exchange regulation imposes an obligation for foreign residents to receive and repatriate the proceeds of an export within 150 days from the actual date of the export. In relation to the imports, the idea is that the banks check the payments made and check the, let's say, the reality of the transaction with respect to services. There is, at least formally, the requirement. In practice, what we have been seeing is that it is we don't see really an evidence being provided of that. Is that banks check that there has been an actual service provision that took place, and that will be paid for or has been paid for. There are also, with respect to expats, the provisions of the foreign exchange regulations, if they haven't been implemented by the BEAC, would dictate that expats that are considered, those that are considered resident in country, and for example, a circular letter that was issued by the BEAC already clarified that expats working offshore, so in FPSOs, platforms, and so forth, are not residents, that payments to income to expats by foreign resident companies and branches would have to be made into local bank accounts, and then they would have to remit them outside the country. However, the BEAC has already issued on 14 August 2019 a circular letter with number 18 that gives them flexibility, because it provides for a system of delegation where the expat worker can issue a declaration of delegation so that his employer directly remits payment to his offshore bank accounts in his home country. The employer will, in that case, have to supply banks with a bunch of information each time it does the transfer directly to an offshore bank account of a resident or non-resident worker, and then every 6 months it has to banks have to be provided with a list of the payments made with some detail. These are in Annex 1 and 2 of the circular letter. At the same time, with respect to those that receive their work-related income in a non-shore bank account, the foreign exchange regulation already provides that they are entitled to transfer in whole or in part their revenues to their home countries, provided they file the necessary supporting documentation. And circular letter 18 basically clarifies that what they are required to evidence to their banks is that they have paid their local subsistence expenses like rents, hotel charges, and so forth. If they can't provide this evidence, they can, in any case, transfer 75% of their revenues. The provision, the new foreign exchange regulation also includes provisions about direct and portfolio investments. Basically, the direct investments are investments in shares and similar instruments equal to or exceeding a 10% stake, or real estate in investments. Portfolio investments are all other investments related to shares or titles representing debts. And to our knowledge, although the BEAC had prepared a draft instruction on the procedures regarding direct and portfolio investments, to our knowledge, no specific instruction has been approved yet. The idea with respect to these investments is that inbound direct investments and portfolio investments need to be notified 30 days in advance. The same applies to outbound portfolio investments. However, outbound direct investments, I mean investments abroad, need to be authorized by the bank. With respect to the transfer of dividends and invest proceeds and similar remittances, they're free in the sense that there are no restrictions, provided the supporting documentation is filed. And obviously, the documentation necessary may include the evidence that the requirements regarding with respect to that investment have been complied with. Notably, for example, the prior notification to the BEAC when necessary. Finally, covering the last topic as borrowing and loans. The idea is that to borrow money from non-foreign exchange resident entity, a resident entity needs or individual needs a prior authorization from the bank. It needs to simply notify the bank and the Ministry of Finance 30 days in advance. To lend money, then it needs to a prior authorization. And here the requirements were actually the same under the 2000 regulation, but what had happened in practice is that very often no notifications were made or no authorizations were requested. And when they were requested, even directly to the BEAC, and we have requested a few, actually there was, I mean, we ourselves, we never received a response, a formal response from the BEAC. And the BEAC, and there was some practice, even for those who requested the authorization, to let elapse the 30-day period and then go on with the transaction. The BEAC has already made clear that a written authorization is indeed required. To enforce the regulation, the BEAC has already issued, to our knowledge, 14 instructions covering several topics that we list in this slide, and also several circular letters. There have been also some other less formal communications and notices addressed to banks, credit institutions about specific aspects. We expect more instructions to be issued, notably to address aspects that have yet to be dealt with, or to render more flexible certain provisions. With respect to the supervision of enforcement of the CEMAC, these new CEMAC regulations, there are various levels. At the first level, your CEMAC banks, who are supposed to be checking, especially through the domiciliation procedures or when they process transfers, that the provisions of the new CEMAC regulations are complied with, and they're just 2 days ago, I think, we obtained it to Congo. The CEMAC has distributed a list, a table with listing the specific documents that banks need to request to allow certain transfers to be made to bring more clarity for banks. Then, and banks, if they find a fault, are supposed to report it, for example, you know, failure of repatriation. Then we have, with respect to exports and imports, the customs administrations, and with respect to exports, the new foreign exchange regulation that has a provision that, entails some risks if the customs administrations decide to follow it frequently, because it allows the customs administration of its CEMAC stage to suspend, not to go forward with the clearance of an export until they receive evidence that the proceeds of the previous export have been repatriated. Finally, supervision is powers are shared between the ministries in charge of currency and credit of each CEMAC state and the BEAC. But here we would say that, as opposed to what happened in the 2000 regulation, the BEAC's powers to supervise and punish breaches in these regulations are strengthened significantly, mostly because it is now clear, which was not as very clear under the former regulation, that although the ministries also supervise, check and audit, the sanctions under the regulation, the main ones at least, or the initiative of the sanction, the decision comes from the BEAC, and the BEAC has been given powers even to seize and confiscate amounts in bank accounts. But I'll hand over to Anna so that she explains this in more detail.
Yes, well, the details are not only the general rules are in the regulation, and we have the details in the last instruction that, to our knowledge, has been issued, which is instruction 14 of 10 June 2019. The sanctions, which, as Catarina was saying, are to be imposed, the main of them, at least, by BEAC, they include pecuniary sanctions, fines, which can be quite significant, and we will see some examples, and also non-pecuniary sanctions, including confiscation, prohibition of certain transactions, suspension of activities, temporary closure, suspension or withdrawal of licenses, and in this case directly to the banks in relation to this withdrawal of licenses can be applied by BEAC directly to the banks, and by COBAC, by the Commission, or by and can also be applied, at least in certain cases, to private entities through the ministry of the relevant sector of the CEMAC state. Then the regulation and the instruction contain some specific rules for the infractions. For repeated infractions, fine can be doubled or tripled. The enforcement is there in many occasions, and also in relation to the payment of the fines. So if there is a late payment of fines, there is an application of an interest at the rate of 5% per day. The rule of double jeopardy, which is also provided in the regulation, and another important rule, which is a limit for the application of the fines. So if the fines are accumulated, they cannot surpass 50% of the company's equity that is provided in Article 176 of the regulation. In terms of sanctions, we have listed some examples. The fines are determined by reference to the amount of the transaction, which means that we will be talking about, at least in some cases, about very significant amounts. For instance, 10% of the amount of the transaction for failure to domicile import or export of assets or services, as Catarina was describing before. 100% of the amount concerned if the service import is not an actual transaction of provision of services. And that is really, really important, as we know, because as we also mentioned before, and Catarina detailed that, it is difficult to understand what is exactly the evidence that should be provided to show that the service was an actual service. At what level of detail should the company has to go in order to make sure that this penalty will not be applicable. 10% of non-repatriated export proceeds, in addition to 1 to 9 months of suspension from CEMAC banking system. 2% of export proceeds repatriated to the bank other than domiciliation bank. A fixed amount in case of delay. 20% of amount of payments made by foreign exchange residents to other residents that use foreign bank accounts. The sanctioning process, basically in terms of the breaches can be detected during desk-based audits or during on-site audits. In both cases, the BEAC starts by sending a letter with the findings or with an interim findings report. Then the economic agent may respond and has a deadline to provide this response of 8 days in one situation, of 15 days in the other. In case there is no response or the BEAC deems that the response provided is not sufficient, then there is a notification grounded with the statement of the breaches, and which is served to the economic agent. The statement of breaches, we could have then the application by BEAC of a financial administrative sanction or of a non-financial administrative sanction. The more, of course, the fines are very relevant, but even more relevant can be the application of in extreme situations of a suspension or a prohibition to continue doing transactions through the CEMAC banking system, for instance, for a bank. The economic agent or directors in that case are summoned to a hearing. They may provide their comments in writing at least 72 hours before the hearing. If the economic agent does not attend, it is called to a second hearing. If it still does not attend, then the Sanctions Commission deliberates and applies the sanction. What we have seen now, and this is the official information that has been released by UMAC and by CEMAC, by the BEAC, on these efforts and on these actions that has been taken during this year. The reserves apparently have increased. CEMAC net foreign assets also increased, despite difficulties in the enforceability. And BEAC continues to have working sessions and discussions, not only in CEMAC countries. They have been in CEMAC countries, and they are now. They held yesterday one session in one of them. Today they will be in Chad. Yesterday they were in Congo. So they will continue to these efforts throughout the region, also in the United States, of course, and in other places, to understand exactly what are the issues and to try to address them the best way possible. By the end of May 2019, we understand that 37 files had been received and reviewed by the BEAC, of which 21 pertain to regularization and 16 to requests for opening accounts.
Speaking of the difficulties, one of the difficulties has been from the numbers that quoted. So at the end of May 2019, 37 files had been received and reviewed, and the BEAC refused authorization for these foreign currency bank accounts in 95% of the cases, because it considered that the reasons given by the applicants were not sufficient for them to allow the BEAC to grant the authorization. And this is probably one of the difficulties that has been experienced, is that since instruction 5 is silent and the regulation is also silent, economic companies in particularly struggle to understand when will the BEAC authorize this type of accounts. There has been already an indication that they will that the BEAC will be prepared to authorize them for the petroleum and mining companies, that but there are many issues with respect to for how exactly, because authorizations for bank accounts are not to be, at least under the foreign exchange regulation, blank checks. They are supposed to be linked to the purposes for which the accounts are to be used. Another difficulty that has been that has been appearing, according to companies, and I mean our subsidiaries also have bank accounts in different banks in the region, is a difficulty in terms of delay in not only sending money out of CEMAC countries, but actually even of receiving foreign currency transfers. It may be a problem that with the distribution of information, the release by the BEAC of more clear instructions, especially with respect to the documentation, that this problem will get attenuated, since banks run the risks of being fined and punished if they process a transfer that they shouldn't be, but there was not clarity and detail with regard to the documentation that they would require. This is something that was a natural risk. But actually, the BEAC, in the presentations it made in Equatorial Guinea and in Gabon, showed a slide and made several comments about justifying that 60% of cases of rejection of transfers were due to banks still having sufficient foreign currency to complete the requested transfers, and not being very clear to their clients about the reason for the transfer not being made. So So the BEAC indicated that the delays were not, the position it took was that the delays were not due to the regulation itself or its requirements, but to difficulties of adaptation from banks to the new regulation and the fact that they were requesting the BEAC to give them foreign currency to do a transfer that they should be doing with the 30% of proceeds that they are entitled to keep when funds are repatriated to cover this kind of thing. Probably the difficulties that have been felt or at least expressed firm way have been the difficulties and the concern from the petroleum and mining sectors because there is a fear and actually the regulation and its instructions lead to an increase of costs, because if money has to go through these local bank accounts because of an immediate effect is the immediate cost of banking commissions associated to the transfers. And then if there is a need, if there are no authorizations for foreign currency bank accounts, the problem of foreign currency fluctuation, because the shock exchange rate is back to the euro, but fluctuates freely in relation to other currencies. And the BEAC, by instruction, allows the banks to reduce or increase the price of each currency as fixed by the BEAC in 3%, which can be a lot. And these sectors, what they consider is that the regulation puts into question their operations and even the core strategy of or typical strategy of these sectors where companies are forced and prefer to, because resorting to third-party financing is often expensive and sometimes unfeasible. They need the proceeds as profitable operations to finance operations that are very risky and of unknown success. The BEAC has already indicated that it's flexible and will seek to adjustments. And as Anna said, has been doing for now sections in the various CEMAC countries to express its views, to clarify what's in the regulations, and to hear the various players about what they believe causes them problems and how they can be fixed. And this was to give you an overall idea of what is in the regulation. Thank you for your attention.
Brilliant. Anna, Katrina, can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Brilliant. Well, thank you so much for that. I think there are lots of questions flying in, and we've got 5 minutes, so I think we better just start on a few of these questions. I know we won't have time to get through all of them. So we've got one here, first of all, from Matteo, who's asked what your opinion is on the anti-CFA franc movement. So how would getting rid of such a, the current monetary system, how would it improve economic development for these countries?
I am sorry, we didn't listen to the question.
Okay, So his question is around the CFA franc movement and what your opinion is on there's been an anti-movement, so people who have been sort of fighting against it, as it were. You know, will getting rid of the current monetary systems improve economic development for these countries? Mm.
I assume that the question is, well, there has been, the question is a bit political. There has been, and not legal, but we will talk about it. There has been indeed a trend that says that, you know, when the shock was created, this was a brilliant idea of France, because they would have to import. France was destroyed at the time. They would have to import, goods to reconstruct France from the United States. So the United States did an agreement so that the exchange, there was a parity, a pack between the French franc and US dollars to render less dangerous for France to buy assets, and France had the brilliant idea, let's do this to our colonies. And by the way, if they have to import something, they will import to us, because they have their currency pegged to the French franc, and then, I mean, we'll put a small markup. I think that basically who defends that has this idea, and then that is the idea that, I mean, and France to keep the parity with the Shah forces us to put our foreign currency, the foreign currency that we as sovereign countries have, deposited in the Bank of France instead of being in each country. And that gives, of course, a significant, leverage to, you know, whoever holds your net, your foreign currency reserves. Obviously, if it's in your bank, who has the powers? And I think that who is who has a movement against the Schaff Franks think of this, and the issue is political. I know also that countries such as Equatorial Guinea, that it's not even a francophone country. There's many that ask themselves, why are we there? Why do we really need to be there? Are we pro or against? The issue is a monetary issue. What would happen, and would it be so bad if, you know, the shut down would disappear, and each country would have its currency, and, you know, it could be worth very little depending on the country's economy. It could be bad for some countries with very weak economies. For others, probably it wouldn't be as bad as that. And I think that, you know, depending on the pressure that certain industries do on certain countries, I couldn't completely discard the possibility of them asking themselves whether it's good for them to be in the franc zone.
Okay, brilliant. Thank you, Matteo. I hope that answers your question. It's 12:59, so I'm not going to, because we could, I think, go on for another couple of hours, but I think better just to close here. So from my side, Anna and Catarina, thank you so much for being part of today's presentation. I think, given everything you've talked about, it's certainly a country that here in West Africa, we are looking more at, and certainly our members are recognizing the sort of importance of organizations such as yourselves, with the insight and the knowledge of how foreign exchange challenges can be overcome. So a massive thank you from us here at Invest Africa. And we look forward to hearing sort of any updates that you may have on the topic today.
Thank you. Thank you for the opportunity, and we hope we have this has been useful.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, and thank you very much to the audience as well for listening in. I hope you found this enjoyable. All right. Obrigado.